Good afternoon and welcome to the 2013-14 Bannon Institute, What Good is God? My name is Mick McCarthy. I'm the Executive Director of the Ignatian Center for Jesuit Education at Santa Clara University. The Ignatian Center is charged with promoting and enhancing the distinctively Jesuit Catholic tradition of education here at Santa Clara. And our vision is to become known throughout Silicon Valley and beyond as providing leadership for the integration of faith, justice, and the intellectual life. Today's topic gets right to the heart of this fall's theme of God and culture, secular and the religious good in civil society. A common notion in Western countries is that religion is prone to violence. Therefore, it is often felt that we should keep religion completely within the private sphere. In the public sphere, we should turn our loyalties to a secular nation state, which is often perceived to be much more rational than religions are. Throughout his recent writings, our speaker today has challenged some of these assumptions. What happens, for instance, when loyalty to the nation or to any other ideal becomes a kind of religion? Indeed, it can be argued that there is no essential difference between secular violence and religious violence. William Cavanaugh is a senior research professor and director of the Center for World Catholicism and Intercultural Theology at DePaul University. He received his BA in theology from Notre Dame in 1984 and an MA from Cambridge University in 1987. After working in Santiago, Chile, he began working at the Center for Civil and Human Rights at the Notre Dame Law School. He received a Ph.D. in religion at Duke in 1996, and has published numerous articles and books, most recently, The Myth of Religious Violence, Secular Ideology and the Roots of Modern Conflict, published by Oxford in 2009. Please welcome him as he delivers his lecture entitled Violent Religion or the Sacred State, Violence, Idolatry, and Religion in Civil Society. Professor Cavanaugh.
Thanks, Mick, for that kind introduction. Thanks to everybody who's made my hours here in Santa Clara so far delightful. I've been welcomed by Susan and Teresa and Mick and several others, and have been basking in the sunshine. This Santa Clara reminds me so much of Chicago, where I'm from. Except for the fact that yesterday afternoon the snow was kind of blowing in horizontally, which, as you can imagine, is just murder on the palm trees. So anyway, thank you for inviting me here. It's lovely to be here. I was out for a walk not long ago, and I came upon a man who was very distraught, and he was going to throw himself off a bridge. And I said, wait, there's so much to live for. Don't you believe in God? And he said, yes. And I said, me too. And I said, are you a Christian or a Jew? And he said, I'm a Christian. And I said, me too. Protestant or Catholic? And he said, I'm a Protestant. And I said, me too. What kind? And he said, Baptist. And I said, me too. Are you a Northern Baptist or a Southern Baptist? And he said, Northern Baptist. And I said, me too. Northern Conservative Baptist or Northern Liberal Baptist? And he said, Northern Conservative Baptist. And I said, me too. Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes region or Northern Conservative Baptist New England region? And he said, Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes region. And I said, me too. Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes Region Council of 1879 or Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes Region Council of 1912? And he said, Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes Region Council of 1912. And I said, die, heretic! And I pushed him off the bridge. That joke by Emo Phillips was named in an online poll as the world's funniest joke about religion. And I think the fact that that joke was named the world's funniest joke about religion tells you something about the way people think about religion, that it's peculiarly prone to violence and division and so on. I gave a talk a while back at a college out east, and the talk was called, Does Religion Cause Violence? And as I was making my way to the lecture theater to give the talk, I noticed on one of the posters that somebody had scrawled the word duh. And I thought, yeah, that pretty much sums it up. That's the way we think about these matters. Everybody knows that religion has a dangerous tendency to promote violence, and this is part of the conventional wisdom of Western societies. This is what I call the myth of religious violence, and it goes like this. Religion is a transhistorical and transcultural human impulse that is essentially distinct from secular ideologies and institutions. Religion is more prone to promote violence than secular ideologies and institutions, and therefore religion should be marginalized from public power, and we should fight to defend and spread secular ideals. And in the post-9/11 world, this kind of discourse is everywhere. It tends to color the way we view the rest of the world. We tell ourselves that we have a peaceful, secular type of state in which religion has been tamed in the public sphere. Those crazy people over there, right, usually these days meaning Muslims, they still mix religion with politics, which makes their politics peculiarly dangerous. Their violence is religious, and therefore it's irrational and divisive. Our violence, on the other hand, is secular, rational, and peacemaking, and so, regrettably, we find ourselves forced to bomb them into the higher rationality. That was sarcastic. So today I'm going to challenge that conventional story, and I'm going to do it in this way. I'm going to argue that there is no essential difference between so-called religious and secular ideas and practices. So there's no good reason for thinking that religious ideas and practices are more inherently prone to violence than secular ideas and practices. And third, then, the idea that something called religion is essentially prone to violence is, in fact, an ideological justification that can be and is used to justify the violence of so-called secular orders. Now, if that sounds complicated, let me just put this thesis in simple terms. People kill for all sorts of things. People are just as likely to kill for their country than for a god, maybe more so. And the reason, I think, is that the nation-state, in some contexts, has taken the place of God. American Christians, for example, are far more likely to kill on behalf of the state than on behalf of Jesus. Now, let me be clear from the outset that I do not deny that Christians, Muslims, others can and do use their faith to justify violence. I don't argue, as some people do, for example, that violence is that sort of violence is really political and not really religious. I don't think that distinction holds up for reasons that I'll explain. What I do deny, though, is that such Muslim or Christian or Buddhist violence is of an essentially different and inherently more troublesome nature than violence in the name of supposedly more mundane and secular realities like kings or nations or flags or freedom or oil, etc. And the idea that there is something called religion that is more troublesome can and is used to promote violence on behalf of secular nation states like our own. So I'm going to start with the idea that there is this essential difference between religion and the secular. The famous atheist Christopher Hitchens, he has a best-selling book called God is Not Great, and it's subtitled with typical British understatement, How Religion Poisons Everything. Right? He has all of these, he points to histories of abuses by Christians and Muslims and Confucianists and Jews and so on. But then he also faces up at one point in the book to the fact that atheist regimes, like those of Joseph Stalin and Kim Jong-il, also have been responsible for tens of millions of deaths. He deals with that little problem by declaring that atheist regimes like Stalin's are religious too. And he says, totalitarianism aims at human perfection, which is essentially a religious impulse, and therefore it's a religion. So basically, religion poisons everything because everything poisonous counts as religion, right? At the same time, everything good ends up on the other side of the religious-secular divide. Here's what Hitchens says about Martin Luther King. In no real as opposed to nominal sense, then, was he a Christian. And Hitchens bases this remarkable conclusion on the fact that King was nonviolent. And the Bible, he says, preaches violence cover to cover. So basically, what is not violent cannot possibly be religious because religion is defined as violent. Now, at this point, we could just dismiss Hitchens as being peculiarly confused and so on. We could assume that, no, Stalin is not really religious. He's an atheist. And we could start arguing about who has caused more deaths in the 20th century, atheists or those who believe in God. But if we did that, that would be to assume that we know what counts as religion and what doesn't. Hitchens is useful because he shows that what counts as religion and what doesn't is a very fluid matter and often depends on the political agenda one is pursuing. And Hitchens is by no means alone in this. If you examine arguments that religion causes violence, you find that what counts as religion and what doesn't count as religion is largely incoherent. So in the first chapter of my book, I go through 9 such academic arguments and show that it's a moving target. Let me give you some examples. Martin Marty, preeminent historian of religion, University of Chicago, in a book on public religion, Marty argues that religion has a particular tendency to be divisive and therefore violent. But Marty then lists 17 different definitions of religion, and then he throws up his hands and says, well, we can't really define religion. So let me give you 5 features of what constitutes a religion. And then he proceeds to show how politics fits all 5 of the same features. So religion focuses our ultimate concern, and so does politics. Religion builds community, and so does politics. Religion appeals to myth and symbol, and politics mimics this appeal and devotion to the flag and war memorials and so on down the list. So he offers 5 defining features of religion, and then he shows how politics fits all 5. What he's trying to do, of course, is show how closely intertwined politics and religion are, but what he ends up doing is demolishing any basis for distinguishing between the two. Another example, Mark Juergensmeyer, sociologist whose book Terror in the Mind of God is probably the most prominent academic book about religion and violence, this thesis. It's now in its 3rd edition. According to Juergensmeyer, religion exacerbates the tendency to divide people into friends and enemies, good and evil, us and them, by ratcheting divisions up to a cosmic level, he says. But he's forced to admit the difficulty of separating religious violence from secular violence. So here's what he says. Secular nationalism, like religion, embraces what one scholar calls a doctrine of destiny. One can take this way of looking at secular nationalism a step further and state flatly that secular nationalism is a religion. Now, that's an important concession, as is his claim that the secular is a sort of advanced form of religion. If it's true, though, it subverts the whole basis of his argument and what he's been doing for the last 30 years, which is establishing this sharp divide between religious violence and secular violence. Now, some religion and violence theorists deal with this problem by just openly expanding the definition of religion to fit all kinds of things. This tends to be called a functionalist view of religion, that it doesn't matter so much what you believe in, it's how it functions in your life. So an example of this is a book by Richard Wentz called Why People Do Bad Things in the Name of Religion. Religion, according to Wentz, has a peculiar tendency towards absolutism. But what does he mean by religion? He includes faith in technology, secular humanism, consumerism, football fanaticism. He has this wonderful scene where he describes a kind of non-church-going auto mechanic coming home on Monday night and sitting in front of Monday night football and letting his belly pop open his fly and arranging his sandwiches and his beer just so. And he describes this whole scene in Eucharistic overtones. And he concludes then, perhaps all of us do bad things in the name of religion. Well, I think he should be commended for his consistency in not trying to erect an artificial distinction between religious and secular types of absolutism. But the price of consistency is that he evacuates the argument of any explanatory force or usefulness. The word religion in the title of his book why people do bad things in the name of religion ends up meaning anything people do that gives their lives order and meaning. So a more economical title for the book would have just been Why People Do Bad Things, because the word religion doesn't really have any kind of analytical purpose. Wentz, Hitchens, Juergensmeyer, others, they're not necessarily wrong to include so-called secular things in the category of religion. There's a vast literature on Marxism as a religion, for example. The God That Failed was a famous collection of essays put together by ex-Marxists back in the 1950s, 60s. But this is a constant trope in the academic literature, Marxism as a religion. I could give you lots of quotes, but I'd rather illustrate it in this way. Sorry, I just like doing this. There's a whole iconography in Marxism. There's an extensive body of scholarship that explores civil religion in the United States, which, as Robert Bella says, has its own seriousness and integrity. It requires the same care and understanding that any other religion does. Civil religion. Carolyn Marvin similarly argues that, quote, nationalism is the most powerful religion in the United States, and perhaps in many other countries. Nationalism is the most powerful religion in the United States, and perhaps in many other countries. Scholars who have explored the peculiar myths, symbols, and sacrifices that surround the flag will often come to this kind of conclusion. Let me give you some examples. This is the photo that I asked Oxford University Press to put on the cover of the book, but they thought it would be a little bit incendiary. So they chose a different image, which is not a bad image, but this one is quite arresting. This is the way that American school children used to salute the American flag until Hitler made this gesture unpopular in the 1930s. More examples of this. Sorry, I couldn't resist. Come on, you miss them, don't you? Mount Rushmore. This is the painting. If you go into the Capitol building in Washington and look up into the dome, this is what you'll see. It's a painting done in the 19th century called The Apotheosis of Washington. Apotheosis, the becoming God of Washington, where Washington is being assumed into heaven, surrounded by these mythological figures. So nationalism, one example of this. In the wake of rolling, I don't know if you remember, here in California in 2001, there were rolling blackouts because they had tried to deregulate the electricity industry. And the architect of that deregulation was quoted in the New York Times expressing his belief that free markets always work better than state control. And he said, quote, "I believe in that premise as a matter of religious faith." End quote. And so scholars who take a kind of functionalist, Durkheim sort of view of religion, they take him at his word, right? If it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's a duck. So a survey of religious studies literature finds the following treated under the rubric religion: totems, witchcraft, human rights, Marxism, liberalism, Freudianism, Japanese tea ceremonies, nationalism, sports fanaticism, free market ideology, Alcoholics Anonymous, and a host of other institutions and practices. Alcoholics Anonymous was actually named a religion by a federal judge in 2002. Now, an objection that is probably percolating in your mind. No, we really know that religion is about God or gods, right? All these other things are like religions, but they're not really religions. But if you take that line, then you would have to eliminate things that are usually called religions, like many forms of Buddhism and Confucianism and Taoism, from your list. So what a lot of scholars do then is open up the category a little bit more to try to include those, Buddhism, for example, by picking a term like, instead of God or gods, something like transcendence. The problem is that the more you open up the category that way, the more other kinds of things that are usually labeled secular fall into the definition of religion. Many institutions and ideology that don't explicitly refer to God or gods function in the same way as those that do. So expanding the category of religion to include godless Buddhism makes it difficult to exclude godless Marxism, for example, right? So transcendence, it's hard to imagine a better candidate for transcendence than nationalism. The term transcendence is a tool used by Western scholars that they borrowed from Judeo-Christian theology, where you've got this distinction between a creator God and a creation. But in something like Buddhism, where you don't have that distinction between a creator God and creation, to apply transcendence to Buddhism then means you just have to make it vague. But if you make it vague enough, then all kinds of other things fit into this category of religion, and the exclusivity of the term breaks down very quickly. This, I think, is particularly relevant to the question of violence. You may think I'm just splitting hairs here over an academic definition, but it's really important. As Keith Ward says, he begins his book by saying it's hard to say whether or not religion is violent if you don't know what it is. And then he goes on and does it anyway. But it's particularly relevant to the question of violence. Is there any good reason to suppose that people are more likely to kill for a god than for a nation, for example? Supposing we get specific about this and ask a couple of questions. What percentage of American Christians would kill for Jesus? And what percentage of American Christians would kill for their country? It seems clear that, at least among American Christians, the nation state is subject to far more absolutist fervor than Christianity. For the majority of American Christians, right, even public evangelization is considered to be in poor taste, but most would assume that under certain circumstances it is necessary and laudable to participate in war, for example, which is organized slaughter on behalf of the nation state. I think we have to conclude then that there is no coherent way to isolate religious ideologies with a particular tendency toward violence from their supposedly tamer secular counterparts. Here's the point again. So-called secular ideologies and institutions like nationalism, capitalism, freedom, etc., can inspire just as much violence as so-called religion. Now, again, if all of this sounds like academic hair splitting over definitions, it's really nothing more complicated than what the Bible says about idolatry, right? Here's what the Bible says about idolatry. People treat all kinds of things as gods: golden calves, armies, mammon, or money, right? Even their own bellies, right? Paul, in the letter to the Philippians, says their gods are their bellies. The Bible, of course, teaches that there is one true God among the many false gods, but the Bible does not think that there is one set of religious pursuits and another essentially different set of mundane and secular pursuits. People, in actual fact, treat all kinds of things as gods. So so-called religious and so-called secular ideas and practices often function in the same way. That, I think, is just a basic biblical insight. The problem with Hitchens, then, is not just that he thinks that Stalinism is a religion. The problem is that if he's going to use such an expansive definition of religion, he should do so consistently, but he doesn't, right? So Stalinism counts as religion for Hitchens, but American civil religion does not count as religion for Hitchens. So really, the distinction between religious and secular for Hitchens is the distinction between things that Hitchens likes and things that Hitchens doesn't like, right? It basically comes down to that. Now, another possible objection that I sometimes hear from people is saying, okay, sure, the concept of religion has fuzzy edges. Every concept does. You know, what is culture? What is politics? We can use those expressions even if you can't exactly nail them down, right? But that's not what I'm arguing. I'm not arguing that the problem is that religion has fuzzy edges. The problem is the opposite. The problem is that the religion and violence theorists are unjustifiably clear about what counts as religion and what doesn't count as religion. So certain things, like Islam, get condemned, and certain things, like nationalism, get a pass. They get ignored. So my point here, then, is not to argue either for or against this expansive kind of functionalist definition of religion. I have no intention of trying to solve their endless scholarly debates about whether or not Confucianism is really a religion or Marxism is really a religion. I don't think there is a once and for all definition of religion, and that's the point. My point is that religion is a category that's constructed in different ways, in different places, different times, and according to the interests of who's doing the construction. And to understand why that is, we need to talk a little bit about its history. So I'm going to give you just a little brief. I have a whole chapter on the history of the term religion that has about 300 footnotes, if you're interested, but I'm just going to give you a little brief run through. Charles Kimball's book, When Religion Becomes Evil, begins with the following claim. It is somewhat trite, but nevertheless sadly true, to say that more wars have been waged, more people killed, and these days more evil perpetrated in the name of religion than by any other institutional force in human history. Now, he considers this claim too trite to need proving, so, because he doesn't offer any evidence for it. But if he were to offer evidence for it, you would need a concept of religion that is transhistorical and transcultural, meaning it goes across time and it goes across places, all times and all places. A concept of religion that would be at least theoretically separable from other institutional forces in human history, politics, for example. The problem is that there was no religion considered as something separable from politics until the modern era, and then primarily in the West. So the Romans, for example, had the term religio, where we get our term religion from. But there was no religion-politics distinction. How could there be when Caesar was considered a god, for example? Likewise, if you tried to figure out, are the Aztecs bloody human sacrifices because of their religion or because of their politics, right? The question doesn't make any sense because they don't make those kinds of distinctions. Wilfred Cantwell Smith showed in his landmark 1962 book, The Meaning and End of Religion, that religion as a discrete category of human activity separable from culture, politics, other areas of life is an invention of the modern West. In the course of a detailed historical study of the concept religion, and there's been a library of books done on this in the meantime, Smith concluded that in pre-modern Europe, there was no significant concept equivalent to what we think of as religion. The Romans, again, had this term religio, but it covered all kinds of civic duties and relations of respect that we would consider secular. This is what Augustine says in the 5th century about religio. We have no right to affirm with confidence that religio is confined to the worship of God, since it seems that this word has been detached from its normal meaning, in which it refers to an attitude of respect in relations between a man and his neighbor, which is nothing like what we mean when we talk about religion. In the medieval era, so a Roman would say, religio mihi est, it's religion to me, in the same way that we might say, I read the morning paper religiously, right? It's a kind of binding obligation on me. In the medieval era, the religious-secular distinction was a distinction between two different kinds of Catholic priests. It was the distinction between those who belonged to an order, they were the religious, and diocesan clergy, who were secular clergy, right? Catholics still sometimes talk about joining the religious life as meaning not when you started believing in God, but when you joined the Jesuits, for example. And that's the way it was in the medieval era. In 1400, the religions of England were the various orders, the Benedictines, the Franciscans, the Dominicans, and so on. There was no realm of secular pursuits to which God was indifferent, and though there was a distinction between civil and ecclesiastical authorities, there was no distinction between religion and politics as we conceive it. This distinction, the religious-secular distinction as we know it today, was the creation in the 15th to 17th centuries of the early modern struggles for power between church leaders and civil leaders. And I do a long history of this in the book that I'll just summarize in a couple of sentences here. But it was basically, religion was invented as a universal, essentially interior and private impulse that's essentially separate from politics and other secular concerns. So henceforth, the church's proper area of concern would be alien from politics. So it's a way of taking what the church does and making it apolitical. So the first modern use of this religious secular distinction is found in William Penn and John Locke in the 17th, 18th century. The idea then that religion is a trans-historical and trans-cultural impulse makes this separation of religion and politics appear natural and inevitable, as if it weren't a contingent arrangement of power in society, but it is. This religious-secular distinction, then, so this distinction between church authorities and civil authorities, that gets exported to the rest of the world in the process of colonization. Smith's study concludes that, quote, there is no closely equivalent concept to religion in any culture that has not been influenced by the modern West. There was no such concept in ancient Greek, Egypt, China, India, anywhere else in the ancient world, this religious-secular distinction. So in their initial encounters with the non-Western world, European explorers reported back home with remarkable consistency that the natives have no religion at all. I've got a long list of these in the book. They would report home and say, oh, the natives are savages, they have no religion at all. Once they're colonized, though, then this religious-secular distinction becomes very useful. Because what it does is it allows you to classify the native cultures as being essentially distinct from the business of government. So Hinduism, for example. Hinduism is a term that's first used in the 1780s. There's Hindus before then, but there aren't Hinduism. Hinduism then becomes a religion in the course of British colonization in the 19th century, despite the fact that Hinduism encompasses everything that we would carve up into religion, culture, politics, arts, etc. All of that is put into a box called religion in the 19th century. Why? Well, Fritz Stahl has concluded, quote, Hinduism does not merely fail to be a religion, it's not even a meaningful unit of discourse, end quote. Now, that's not an insult to Hindus. What that means is that talking about Hinduism is like talking about Americanism, right? What does that mean? It could mean a thousand different things, right? But you take that and you make that a religion. Why? Because then, if Hinduism is a religion under British rule, then to be Indian is to be private, and to be British is to be public, right? So you take everything it means to be Indian and you stick it in this box called religion, and then you can push it off into the kind of private realm. And that's exactly why many contemporary advocates of Hindu nationalism, the BJP, the second largest party in India, they refuse to say that Hinduism is a religion. Here's a quote from Richard Cohen. The proponents of Hindutva, Hindu nationalism, refuse to call Hinduism a religion, this is today we're talking about, precisely because they want to emphasize that Hinduism is more than mere internalized beliefs. It is social, political, economic, familial in nature. And for similar reasons, Chinese nationalists in the 19th century refused to say that Confucianism and Taoism were religions. And even today, Confucianism is excluded from the list of official religions in China, document 19 by the Chinese communist government, for the same reason, because Confucianism is kind of representative of the national character, whereas religion is something that's kind of private and divisive. So in her book, The Invention of World Religions, Tomoko Masasawa concludes this concept of religion as a general transcultural phenomenon. It also has a distinct sphere in its own right, is patently groundless. It came from nowhere, and there is no credible way of demonstrating its factual and empirical substantiality. The only part of that quote that I would quibble with is the idea that it came from nowhere. It didn't come from nowhere. It came from Western colonization. The religious-secular distinction is not engraved in the nature of things. It's a distinction that is employed in Western or Westernized societies to marginalize certain kinds of beliefs and practices and to authorize other kinds of beliefs and practices. So in the last part, what I want to do is talk about what kinds of beliefs and practices it authorizes and what kinds it doesn't. So I come to part C of the myth, what the myth of religious violence is used for. If it's so incoherent, why is it so prevalent in our society? This is the last part of the myth of religion's violence. It should be marginalized from public power, and we should fight to defend and spread secular ideals. The idea that religion causes violence is used as justification for this. And that's what I want to analyze. I'm going to look first at the first part of this, the domestic part, and then talk about the foreign policy part. Well into the 20th century, I went back and I looked at all of the Supreme Court cases that dealt with the First Amendment on religion. And what I found was that up until 1940, religion was consistently invoked as being a unitive, a unifying effect in American society. And from 1940 on, it was invoked as a cause of division in American society that has to be marginalized. Why that change occurred at that point in time is a matter I can't get into. But it's really quite remarkable what happens. The first Supreme Court case to invoke this myth of religious violence is Minersville School District versus Gobitis in 1940, which upheld compulsory pledging of allegiance to the American flag. Writing for the majority, Justice Felix Frankfurter writes this: centuries of strife, this is the Jehovah's Witnesses have brought this case, centuries of strife over the erection of particular dogmas as exclusive or all-comprehending faiths led to the inclusion of a guarantee for religious freedom in the Bill of Rights. The First Amendment sought to guard against repetition of those bitter religious struggles by prohibiting the establishment of a state religion and by securing to every sect the free exercise of its faith. So he decided that the Jehovah's Witnesses didn't have to salute the American flag if they didn't want to or if they thought it violated their religious principles, right? Wrong. The Jehovah's Witnesses' dissent threatens the promotion of national cohesion. We are dealing with an interest inferior to none in the hierarchy of legal values. National unity is the basis of national security. What the school authorities are really asserting is the right to awaken in the child's mind considerations as to the significance of the flag, contrary to those implanted by the parent. That's, as a parent, I find that a little bit chilling. Now, the court would reverse itself 3 years later, but in the meantime, there was all kinds of violence done to Jehovah's Witnesses in the United States for refusing to salute the American flag. They had pamphlets saying why a follower of Jesus Christ cannot salute the flag. They consider it to be idolatry and still do. But the Supreme Court ruled, at least temporarily, that they could be forced to do it. Frankfurter had succeeded in introducing the idea that First Amendment decisions could be based on this unspecified history of religious violence, bitter religious struggles, and the antidote to this is national unity. Now, Martin Marty discusses this case, and he cites the many instances of Jehovah's Witnesses who were attacked, beaten, tarred, castrated, imprisoned in the U.S. in the 1940s. Because they believe that followers of Jesus Christ cannot salute a flag. Now, one would think that he would draw the obvious conclusion that zealous nationalism can cause violence. Astonishingly, he concludes, it became obvious that religion which can pose us versus them or them versus what we think the state should be or do, carries risks and can be perceived by others as dangerous. Religion can cause all kinds of trouble in the public arena. Now, what Marty means by religion only refers to the Jehovah's Witnesses' refusal to salute the flag. He doesn't mean by religion the ritual vowing of allegiance to a flag. So in this way, the myth of religious violence is used to draw attention away from nationalist violence and towards so-called religious violence, even though in this case, the Jehovah's Witnesses were the ones getting beat up. They were the ones suffering the violence and not doing it. And this is the way it tends to work. In the succeeding decades, then, the myth of religious violence is invoked by the Supreme Court in case after case after case, in decisions banning school prayer, forbidding voluntary religious instruction on public school property, forbidding state aid to parochial school teachers, and on and on. When this court banned school prayer in the Abington case in 1963, Justice Potter Stewart dissented, and he said, "We're establishing a religion of secularism here." He warned against the establishment of a religion of secularism, he called it. And he noted, for example, the long history of, like, the Supreme Court, for example, opens up its sessions with "God Save This Honorable Court." So two of his fellow justices replied to him in this way. And they said, this is Justices Goldberg and Harlan, they addressed this objection by drawing a sharp line between patriotic invocations of God and religious ones. There is, of course, nothing in the decision reached here that is inconsistent with the fact that school children and others are officially encouraged to express love for our country by citing historical documents which contain references to the deity, or with the fact that there are many manifestations in our public life of belief in God. Such patriotic or ceremonial occasions bear no true resemblance to the unquestioned religious exercise that the state has sponsored in this instance, meaning school prayer, which was banned. So they don't offer any reason why patriotic invocations of God bear no true resemblance to religious invocations. But it's clear that what, in their mind anyway, what separates religion from what is not religion is not the invocation of God. Right? You can invoke God in public ceremonies without those ceremonies becoming religious exercises, provided that you express love for our country. So separating religion from non-religion in this case depends not on the presence or absence of expressions of faith in God, but on the presence or absence of expressions of faith in the United States of America. So American nationalism is the antidote for religious divisiveness, and revulsion to killing or dying in the name of one's religion is one of the ways we become convinced that killing and dying in the name of America is laudable and proper, which brings me to foreign policy. The conventional wisdom helps reinforce and justify Western attitudes and policies toward the non-Western world, especially Muslims these days, whose primary point of difference with the West is said to be their stubborn refusal to tame religious passions in the public sphere. So Hitchens, for example, skewers religion as being particularly violent, but he was an enthusiastic supporter of the Iraq War and other Western military adventures in the Muslim world. Despite his attempt to draw Martin Luther King to his side, Hitchens has some very approving things to say about killing people. Quote, "And I say to the Christians while I'm at it, go love your own enemies. By the way, don't be loving mine. I think the enemies of civilization should be beaten and killed and defeated, and I don't make any apology for it." End quote. So for Hitchens, the Iraq War was part of a broader war for secularism. He called it Bush's War for Secularism. And the game is zero sum. Quote, "It's not possible for me to say, well, you pursue your Shiite dream of a hidden imam, and I pursue my study of Thomas Paine and George Orwell, and the world is big enough for both of us. The true believer cannot rest until the whole world bends the knee," end quote. Now, what Hitchens means by the true believer is the Muslim, right? But Hitchens' message is that the true believer in secularism can also not rest until the whole world has been converted to secularism by force, if necessary. Let me give one more example, one more set of examples. Also, one of the new, so-called new atheists, Sam Harris, his book, The End of Faith, illustrates this double standard. He, for example, condemns the irrational religious torture of witches, but then later in the book he has a rationale for torturing terrorists. And his book is charged with the conviction that the secular West cannot reason with religious people because they're irrational, so you can only deal with them by force. Some propositions are so dangerous that it may even be ethical to kill people for believing them. Certain beliefs place their adherents beyond the reach of every peaceful means of persuasion while inspiring them to commit acts of extraordinary violence against others. There is, in fact, no talking to some people. If they cannot be captured, and they often cannot, otherwise tolerant people may be justified in killing them in self-defense. And this is what the United States attempted in Afghanistan, and it is what we and other Western powers are bound to attempt at an even greater cost to ourselves and innocents abroad, elsewhere in the Muslim world. We will continue to spill blood in what is, at bottom, a war of ideas. Now, his logic here is impeccable, right? Religious people are irrational because they believe these crazy things, so you can't deal with them rationally. You can only deal with them by force. So the myth of religious violence becomes a justification for the use of violence. In a chapter entitled The Problem with Islam, Harris writes, quote, "In our dialogue with the Muslim world, we are confronted by people who hold beliefs for which there is no rational justification, and which therefore cannot even be discussed. And yet these are the very beliefs that underlie many of the demands they are likely to make upon us," end quote. Now, he says this is especially a problem if they gain nuclear weapons. There is little possibility of our having a Cold War with an Islamist regime armed with long-range nuclear weapons. In such a situation, the only thing likely to ensure our survival may be a nuclear first strike of our own. Needless to say, this would be an unthinkable crime, as it would kill tens of millions of innocent civilians in a single day. But it may be the only course of action available to us, given what Islamists believe. He goes on to say that Muslims would then likely misinterpret this act of self-defense as a genocidal crusade. I swear I'm not making this up. Thus plunging the world into nuclear holocaust. All of this is perfectly insane, of course. I've just described a plausible scenario in which much of the world's population could be annihilated on account of religious ideas that belong on the same shelf with Batman, the Philosopher's Stone, and Unicorn. So in other words, if we have to slaughter millions of people in a nuclear first strike, it's their fault because they're crazy. Now, before we get to that point, Harris continues, we must encourage civil society in Islamic countries, but we cannot trust them to vote it in, right? So one more quote from Harris. "It seems all but certain that some form of benign dictatorship will generally be necessary to bridge the gap. But benignity is the key, and if it cannot emerge from within a state, it must be imposed from without. The means of such imposition are necessarily crude. They amount to economic isolation, military intervention, some combination of both. While this may seem an exceedingly arrogant doctrine to espouse, gee, you think, it appears we have no alternatives." Now, Harris's book is a particularly blunt version of this type of justification of violence, but he's by no means an isolated voice. His book was a New York Times bestseller. It won the 2005 Penn Award for Nonfiction, and it has been enthusiastically endorsed by such academic superstars as Alan Dershowitz and Richard Dawkins and Peter Singer. This is the same Peter Singer who doesn't believe that it's justifiable to kill non-rational animals for food. Apparently, non-rational Muslims is a different question. Now, and Harris's logic in practice, I think, is little different from the Bush's national security doctrine, which says that America has access to liberal values that are right and true for every person in every society. That's a quote. "We must use our power to promote such values on every continent, and America will take preemptive military action if necessary to promote such values." Now, to conclude then, I don't want either to deny the virtues of liberalism or excuse the vices of other kinds of social orders. What I'm trying to do is level the playing field so that we examine the violence that can be generated by the concept of jihad, for example, but we also examine the violence that can be generated by ideologies of free markets and free elections. We examine the violence that can be generated by the sacrificial atonement of Christ, but we also examine the violence that can be done by secular forms of nationalism. So put simply, my argument is that people kill for all sorts of things. People, things like money and flags and freedom and oil that function as gods in people's lives. So I want to challenge the religious secular dichotomy that causes us to turn a blind eye to liberal forms of imperialism and violence. Insofar as the myth of religious violence creates the villains against which a liberal social order defines itself, the myth is little different than previous forms of Western imperialism that established the inferiority of non-Western others and subjected them to Western power in the hopes that we could make them be more like us. If the argument is taken seriously, it would neither vilify Western-style liberalism nor justify theocracy, but help us to see that these are not the only two choices that there are. We sometimes think that the Islamic world has to choose between Iran or Canada, and I think there are lots of other options in between. Violence feeds on the need for enemies, the need to separate us from them. And these binary ways of viewing the world make the world understandable for some, but unlivable for many. And so doing away with this binary and this myth of religious violence, I think, is one way of resisting those divisions of the world and perhaps turning some enemies into friends. Thank you. So I'm open for questions. Yes?
Yeah, I actually read this book. I'm using it for a class to teach you this week. So,
can y'all hear me? Do I need this? It's what? Oh, it's recorded. So one of the questions I had in reading this book, your argument bears kind of a formal similarity to a lot of discussion going on right now of the issues in Western culture for the last 600 years or so. And a lot of these come up in context of kind of two narratives. One is of liberalism, which you've already mentioned, but the other, and my tie-in here would be the kind of royal sacrality and messianism that you talk about in the book in the 16th and 17th centuries to Vogelin's discussion of Gnosticism. Mm-hmm. And that what we have in the last 600 years or so is a strong kind of Gnostic movement, and this explains the sort of messianic sacred elements. It seems to me you've already tied in to some extent your trajectory here with the history of liberalism. I didn't find in the book, and so I ask you here now, is there any tie-in at all with this sort of Gnostic framework? Do you have anything to say on that sort of question?
That's interesting. You know, I haven't read much Vogelin, and I should. I find that the term Gnosticism just gets, it's one of those terms that's just subject to tremendous inflation. And so it covers just damn near everything. And so now there's been a kind of backlash against the use of Gnosticism in this broad sort of sense. If by Gnosticism is meant the kind of division of the body from the soul, I suppose, is that the way
It depends. You know, there's varieties of it. I'm thinking of the particularly Joachite strand of Gnosticism that sees these kind of ages of the world, yeah, and that everything's moving to this realization of kind of an earthly paradise or of some sort under the auspices of some kind of a revolutionary leadership.
Yeah, that's what I would call Christianity. You know,
this is a Christian. But this is a Christian version of it, in Vogelin's phrase, immanentizing the eschaton.
Sure.
That there's a taking the Augustinian view of the end times and bringing it down to earth and making it, as it were, the goal of earthly endeavor rather than something that is realized by the Lord's return.
Sure, yeah. I mean, and similar arguments are made about Marxism all the time, that it's a kind of heretical version of Christianity. And I think that's probably true in some senses of the creation of nation states as well. The church fails. You know, I mean, I think we have to admit that this is not something that they did to us, but it comes on the heels of the failures of the church to instantiate a kind of body of peace. And so there become these kind of heretical versions of Christianity that are parasitic on other forms of life once the church gets subsumed under the nation state. And I think that's right. I mean, I think we need to kind of take admit Christian guilt in that, but not succumb to the temptations of these kind of updated forms of Christianity without a Christ. You know. Are there any? That sounded awfully academic. Are there any undergraduates that? Please.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. As you said, Hitchens and Harris believe that violence could be justified when it's defending liberal ideals against people with whom you can't have a rational discussion. And some radical Islamists believe that violence can be justified against the unbeliever. Are there any circumstances that you believe justify violence at all?
Yeah, that's a tough question. What I'm in this book and in this argument, I'm not making an argument either for what are for me as a Catholic the two options, either pacifism or the just war theory. That's a whole nother kettle of fish, a can of worms, whatever the your preferred metaphor is. I think in a lot of ways that the pacifist tradition and the just war tradition are not two separate traditions, they're concentric circles, but that's a whole other question. What I'm trying to do in this book is level the playing field so that when we come to questions like that, is violence ever justified, and if so, how? Then we're talking about violence and not religious violence versus secular violence and trying to make what I think are artificial sorts of distinctions that just distort the analysis. So I think certainly the majority opinion in Catholic tradition is for the just war idea, that there are some circumstances under which war can be justified. But to do that, to think rightly about that, I think first of all we need to kind of clear away some of these problems. Let me go a little bit down that road and talk about part of the problem with doing just war reasoning now is that in the original formulation of the just war idea, it wasn't thought that you stepped outside of the church to do your discernment on this. You tried to think with Jesus on these questions. In the modern day era, what the just war theory means is that the president decides on completely secular grounds whether or not to go to war, and then Catholic theologians publish op-ed pieces in the Wall Street Journal explaining why it's justified, right? And so if we're going to have the just war theory, what we need to have is discernment that takes the gospel seriously and not just political expediency. And so the church has to do its thinking on this and not just leave it to the president to make these decisions. And the second thing we have to have is the guts to say no sometimes. I mean, the problem with the just war theory is that we always say yes. It's always used to justify war. And if, for example, in 2003, when the Pope and the U.S. bishops were raising very strong objections to this being a just war. Imagine what would have happened if significant numbers of Catholics have said, yeah, we're going to follow the Pope on this, and we're going to sit this one out. I mean, if you're going to have a just war theory, at least theoretically, you have to be able to say, okay, this one's just, and we'll fight this one. But this one is not just, and we're not going to fight this one. But the problem is it never seems to work that way. It always seems to be that we just go kill whoever they tell us to go kill, and then we work out the reasons for it later. But that's going down another... that's a long-winded way of saying that even, never mind pacifism for the moment, if we took the just war theory seriously, it would have tremendously radical consequences. And I think in a lot of ways, Christians aren't willing to face up for that. What we really practice is not the just war theory. What we really practice is the blank check theory, where we give the government a blank check and we go kill whoever they tell us to go kill. Yeah.
Let me ask this subsumed question. Isn't a specific belief in God necessarily divisive?
Divisive between somebody who believes in God and somebody who doesn't believe in God, for example. Yeah, well, that's true, but that can be said about just about anything that people take seriously, right? I mean, the belief that the belief in Platonism is exclusive of the belief in Kantianism. The belief in democracy as the greatest form of government is divisive in the sense that it excludes people that believe in theocracy and monarchy and so on. So yes, it's true that belief in God in some sense can be divisive and excludes people that don't believe in God. But trying to find a neutral place to stand is going to be awfully difficult. And the real question is, what do we do with our differences? Part of the problem is that liberalism is the belief that we can't disagree without killing each other. And in some senses, what Christianity is the belief that we can be different from one another without killing one another. We can love our enemies and bless those who persecute us. And we can also find ways of living together with people that are different, including people that don't believe in God at all. Yeah, I mean, and that I think is the lesson of the cross.
Yeah. Hi, thank you very much for sharing with us today. You are not the first speaker for this series to bring up Chris Hitchens and talk about his opinions and what he's written about. And I'm just curious, do you find, or did you find, if you read it, his last book that he wrote as he was dying, any reconciliation with his beliefs about faith, God, and the possibility that all these things are real and true, and it's just something to find out?
I'm sorry, I just remember now that I was supposed to have been repeating the questions, haven't I? Yeah, sorry about that. So the question is, what do I think of Christopher Hitchens' last book that he wrote as he's dying? I haven't read it, I'm sorry. Can you explain a little bit what he says there? I know he's sort of in dialogue with his brother, who is a Christian believer. In that book, does he come to some reconciliation or not?
He was open to the possibility.
Just a little bit,
and he would wait to see.
Okay, well, he probably knows more than we do by now.
Yes, so, but I found it interesting. You know, he was a very engaging mind, and. You know, even if you don't believe the way he believed, he would be a brilliant person to have a conversation with.
He's an interesting guy.
Yeah.
I mean, his book on Henry Kissinger is, he's hilarious and devastating and very unfair. on any issue that you could get him going on. He would always fight unfair. He never fights fair. Mm-hmm. But he's an interesting guy.
He had a good mind.
But he did. He did have a good mind, and he's an interesting guy. I think his book on God Is Not Great is out to lunch, in for the reasons that I said. But there's a lot of things by him that are worth reading. He was a sensationalist. He wasn't someone who was after the truth as much as he was someone who was after... You're right, yeah.
I may not have this exactly right, but I think in your lecture you said that Supreme Court jurisprudence prior to 1940 tended to treat religion as a unifying social force. After that, it was kind of more sectarian understanding of religion. Mm-hmm. And you didn't tell us why? Could you just fill that out a little bit? Because that's a fairly significant turn, if that's true.
It is. So the question again is, I said in 1940 there's a turn from Supreme Court cases citing religion as being a unifying aspect of American society, and after 1940s it's consistently quoted as a divisive aspect. And there have been various theories about this. Frederick Geddix has some interesting books where he talks about this shift from what he calls religious communitarianism to secular individualism that happens right about that era somewhere. And there's a lot of different explanations. From the lawyer's point of view, it has something to do with the secularization of universities and the secularization of legal education, which happens after you begin to get the foundation of secular universities in the United States. I think Johns Hopkins may have been the first in 1876. And then in jurisprudence, you get the importation of critical legal theory from Europe that has a strong effect on this as well. The other causes, I suppose there's all kinds of sociological causes that you could point to. After World War I, the idea of Christendom kind of falls apart and the churches kind of go into crisis, in Europe especially, but I think that may have carryovers into American life as well. So that's the best I can do at an explanation. I'm sure there are other causes as well.
Does it correspond with increasing understanding and appreciation of religious pluralism? That not all the world is Christian, for instance?
Yeah, I just... it happens in theory long before it happens in practice, in some ways. I mean, what's remarkable about these Supreme Court cases is how removed from empirical observation they are. So there, you know, the Everson case in 1947, where the wall of separation between church and state is invoked by Justice Hugo Black. And it's kind of resurrected from when Jefferson had said it back in the 18th century in a very different context. It's a case about whether or not Catholic school kids can ride the public school buses in New Jersey. And you look at the reasoning behind this, and he goes right back to the 16th and 17th centuries and starts talking about the so-called wars of religion in Europe, in order to make this case that you need to have this strict wall of separation between church and states. It's got nothing to do with the actual reality, the actual empirical reality on the ground. And this is the case as you, even more the case as you get further. You know, so 1971, in the Lemon versus Kurtzman case, they're again fretting about the divisiveness of religious violence in the case where you've already got, this is about paying Catholic school teachers, you've already had a Catholic president, the kinds of violence that they're warning against are at an absolute historic low. You know, as I say in the books, are the Supreme Court justices in 1971 really worried that a roving band of Rhode Island Presbyterians is going to, you know, attack St. Agnes Grade School and shoot the teacher in the middle of her Mount Rushmore slideshow, you know. I mean, this is while, of course, we're carpet bombing Vietnamese villages, right? And they're worried about the divisive, violent effects of you know, this subsidy that Rhode Island has added to parochial school teachers' pay, you know, even though when the bill came up in the Rhode Island legislation, it didn't cause any major problems any more than any other kind of legislation happens. But so the divide between the actual situation on the ground and what you find in these decisions is really remarkable. Oh, wasn't anybody offended? I've had people stand up and denounce me angrily. So I'm not doing my... any undergraduates that want to get in, question things? Everybody's laid back. That's great. Yeah.
I can speak for some students. Sam, you know more about this. Mr. Conadera is teaching a course in the Crusades. You got a bunch of essays back, you told me, in which the students were lambasting the Catholic Church for the Crusades, that it was a good example of the use of religious violence because of the nature of the Catholic religion. Am I misconstruing?
No, that's right. There's, I mean, what you're describing as a common thesis, I mean, I think that's right.
Yeah.
Sort of,
when
people grow up.
Well, and I mean, let's not. Sure. So the question again is about the Crusades, right? A lot of students react to this and say this is an example of religious violence. There's no way to sugarcoat the Crusades. It was bad. This is one of the sins that the Catholic Church needs to do penance for. But saying that if that's religious violence and it's of essentially different nature than so-called secular violence, that's what I don't buy, right? I mean, the number of people killed in the Crusades pales compared to what happened in Iraq in March of 2003. And we just don't. I mean, that just doesn't enter into our minds. There's an annual conference in Qatar where American diplomat or Western diplomats and Muslim leaders get together and talk. And there was a remarkable speech by an American diplomat named David Satterfield in, I think it was 2007, where there was, after the war, there was sectarian violence in Iraq. And he stands up and gives a speech and says, we're not going to stand back and let people impose their will on Iraq through the use of violence. And I came upon this in an article by Rami Khoury, a Middle Eastern journalist, who said, did the U.S. not use weapons when they invaded Iraq? Right? I mean, this, our violence, just doesn't count as violence. It's just not, that's peacemaking or something else. But their violence counts as violence. So that's what I, but there is no sugarcoating the Crusades. The Crusades were bad, and the church needs to do penance for that. I have an article in the Journal of Faith and International, the Review of Faith and International Affairs, called How to Do Penance for the Inquisition. It's actually a chapter in this book, How to Do Penance for the Inquisition. And it's about torture and how these narratives get played out in terms of distancing ourselves. Torture is what they do over there, or it's what those people did back then. So, oh, the Catholic Church, the Inquisition, torture, all that kind of stuff. That's why we need to be secular today. And so my argument is, in order to do penance for the Inquisition, what we need to do is resist the torture that's being done in our names today by a so-called secular government. So, yeah.
Just addressing and going farther with what we've been saying, couldn't we say, hey, the Crusades were, these people don't believe in Christianity, they don't hold our beliefs, we're going to kill them. Whereas what we do in the Middle East. Some people, like what Christopher Hitchens said, I will go out and beat up whoever wants to attack civilization, and I won't feel bad about it. Couldn't we say that violence in defense of liberty is more justified than violence because you don't hold the same beliefs I do?
Could we say that it is more justified?
Yeah, couldn't we say these people, they're not rational. Many Islamist radicals will kill us just because we don't hold their beliefs. Can we say our violence is more justified in the sense that we are defending innocence and liberty rather than imposing our beliefs on others, what was done in the Crusades?
Okay, so to repeat the question, could we not say that our violence, if it's done to defend freedom, is more justifiable than violence done to impose one's faith views on another? I think my short answer to that question is no. I really want to resist that, because it becomes a way then of justifying any kind of violence that we do. And in some ways it's worse, because when you want to make the world safe for democracy, then everybody is open for invasion, in a sense. Right? I mean, this is what happens in some ways. Kant writes a book called Perpetual Peace, where he argues that the spread of what we would call liberalism is going to make the world a more peaceful place, because Germans won't go to war against French just because they're German and they're French. The problem is that once you went to war for more parochial reasons, and now you go to war for more universal reasons. And so John Lukács says that the great revolutionary of the 20th century is not Lenin, it's Woodrow Wilson, because Wilson wants to make the whole world safe for democracy. And this has been the mantra. If you read Basevich's book, American Empire, he's a retired army colonel who now teaches political science at Boston University. And he's written a book called American Empire, where he looks back and looks at the justifications for war in the 20th century, and says that the justification is always openness, free markets, and free elections. And that then makes it possible to see the other as infinitely invadable if they're not like us. I mean, the danger is that once violence becomes universalizable, then it's spreadable everywhere. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that in particular cases, certain acts might be more justified than other acts, right? What I'm trying to do is get the level of analysis as close to the ground as you possibly can, right? And not up at this level of talking about Islam is like this, because Islam is a faith of 1.2 billion people, and it means all sorts of different things. And getting away from making these kind of categorical distinctions between our violence and their violence. So I really, really want to resist the idea that those things are categorically different things. They may, under certain circumstances, American military action is different than somebody who goes into a cafe with a backpack full of explosive and blows themselves up. But that comparison may not always work to our advantage, right? We very easily condemn bombs in backpacks, but we have a blind spot when it comes to bombs dropped from airplanes or drones. That are now being done in our names. Innocent people get killed by drones every week, and we say, you know, make an omelet, you got to break some eggs, you know. And I think that's problematic. Thanks. Yes.
Thank you, Bill, for such a challenging lecture. And thank you to everybody else who has come. Please take a moment to fill out. It's very helpful for us to have your feedback, either here, or if you RSVP'd, you should have a link to a kind of like a web place. There are books available outside, so if you would like to get a book, I'm sure the author will be happy to sign them for you. And we greatly appreciate all of your support for the many events we've held this past quarter. Due to unforeseen circumstances, unfortunately, Guadalupe Unbound lecture, originally scheduled for November 19th, has been canceled. We do have a number of exciting Bannon Institute offerings lined up for the winter quarter, so please check out our website for details. Let us thank the speaker one more time.